بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. قال المصنف الشيخ عبد الله سراج الدين نفعنا الله به وبكم في كتابه سيدنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. الشيخ عبد الله سراج الدين، may Allah سبحانه وتعالى benefit us through him and through you, says in his book سيدنا محمد رسول الله, our master Muhammad, the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال Okay, let's see where we reached up to. قال وقد ذكر العلماء للحياء أنواعا لتنوع أسبابه، فمن ذلك حياء الكرم، وسبب كرم النفس كاستحيائه صلى الله عليه وسلم من قومي لما أطال الجلوس عنده كما تقدم، ومن ذلك حياء الإجلال، وهو حياء سببه المعرفة بعظمة المستحيا منه، وعلى قدر معرفة العبد بربه يكون حياؤه سببه منه سبحانه. So here he says the scholars have mentioned that there are several types of shyness. So we're talking about haya. Several types of shyness defined according to its cause. So generous shyness is that which is caused by a generous soul, such as the Prophet ﷺ's shyness when the people sat with him for too long, as we have seen. So his shyness was that he was shy to tell them to leave. So this is from a generous shyness. And that's this is a story of when he first married Zainab. And the people had come to eat and they wouldn't leave. So it's in Surah Hujarat, we spoke about last week. Then the next is reverent shyness is that which is caused by recognition of the majesty of the being one is shy of. And the more the servant knows of his Lord's majesty, the more shy he will be before him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا رَيْبَ أَنَّهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَعْلَمُ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى بِاللَّهِ تَعَالَى وَبِعَظَمَةِ رُبُوبِيَتِهِ كَمَا تَقَدَّمَ فِي حَدِيثِ الصَّحِيحَيْنِ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ أَمَا وَاللَّهِ إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمُكُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَأَتَّقَاكُمْ لَهُ. And there's no doubt that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew Allah's majesty better than any of his creation. Bukhari Muslim narrate in their Sahih collections that he sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Wallahi, by Allah, I am the most knowledgeable of you concerning Allah and the most conscious of him, most have the most taqwa of him. وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ حَيَاءُ الْمَحَبَّةِ وَهُوَ حَيَاءُ الْمُحِبِّ مِنْ مَحْبُوبِي حَتَّى إِنَّهُ لَتَمُرُّ عَلَى قَلْبِ الْمُحِبِّ ذِكْرَيَاتِ الْمَحْبُوبِ فَتَزِيدُهُ حَيَاءً وَوَجِلًا مِنْ مَحْبُوبِهِ. And loving shyness is the shyness of the lover for his beloved, so that whenever thoughts of the beloved cross his mind, his shyness and concern for him increase. Here, it's more like, so there's, it's a kind of the a shyness of love, meaning when you feel so indebted to someone. I would put it that way. When you feel so somebody is giving you so much, and so it's when you remember their good. So he says whenever thoughts of the beloved cross his mind, so whenever you remember how much good they've given you, you increase in your shyness. And فَتَزِيدُ حَيَاءً وَوَجِلًا. This is he increases in his shyness. It's more like embarrassment here, like, oh, like, you know, you there's no way you can I can repay that person. And even it increases in his love, it increases your love for that person. So this is kind of, you know, it's like the love that we would have for somebody who's been really good to us, or even, you know, yes, of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba, when we think of them, the scholars, our teachers, our parents, our spouses, inshallah, our spouses are from those people as well. So, you know, but those people who have done a lot for us. ومن ذلك حياء العبودية وهو حياء يمتزج بين محبة وخوف مشاهدة أن قدر معبوده سبحانه هو أجل وأعلى من العبادة والعبودية التي يتقرب بها إليه. worshipful shyness is a shyness that combines love, fear, and the awareness that Allah's true rank. Let's see. That Allah's true أنا قدر معبودي. That Allah's true rank is far but beyond the acts of worship by means of which the servant draws near to him. Meaning the Allah's what he deserves or what he is like what he's entitled to is more than we could ever do from worship, right? So whatever we do of worship is just not good enough. So it's the shyness of worship is it combines, you know, this of love and also fear and recognition at the same time, recognizing that whatever we do of worship is not good enough. ومن ذلك حياء المرء من نفسه وهو حياء صاحب النفس الشريفة الكريمة من النقص وفعل القبيح والقناعة بالدون فيجد نفسه مستحيا من نفسه حتى كأن له نفسين يستحي بإحداهما من الأخرى. A person's shyness from his own self is a shyness that a noble, righteous person possesses, shyness on account of defects and shameful actions and reliance on others. This person finds that he is shy of his own self as though he has two souls or two kind of persons, one of which is shy of the other. So meaning that, you know, shyness of embarrassed from one's own self of what they did. Oh, that, you know, they didn't do this correctly, or I'm embarrassed of. So even if nobody else sees it, but that person is embarrassed of oneself, that he didn't do enough. So that's another kind of shyness or haya. ومن ذلك حياء الحشمة وهو حياء سبب الاحتشام والتوقي إبداء ما يطلب فيه إخفاء. وتوقي إبداء ما يطلب فيه الإخفاء. The shyness of decorum is shyness caused by modesty and care to conceal that which should be concealed. روى ابن ماجه عن ابن بلال بن الحارث رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا أراد الحاجة أبعد أي قصد مكانا بعيدا منعزلا. وروى الترمذي وأبو داود عن أنس رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا أراد الحاجة لم يرفع ثوبه حتى يدنو من الأرض. وروى ابن سعد عن سعد بن صلاح المرسل أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا دخل المرفق لبس حذاءه وغطى رأسه صلى الله عليه وسلم. So here, Tirmidhi and sorry, before that, Ibn Majah narrate that Bilal ibn al-Harith radiallahu anhu said that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to answer the call of nature, he would seek a distant place, i.e. far from people. So a place that was private. So this is, you know, wanting to cover that which should be covered. Tirmidhi and Abu Dawud narrate that Anas radiallahu anhu said when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to answer the call of nature, he would not lift his robe until he was close to the earth. Ibn Sa'd narrated that Sa'd ibn Salah said when the Prophet ﷺ entered the place where he would relieve himself, he would wear his shoes and cover his head. So لَبِسَ حِذَاءَهُ, so it's like feet wouldn't get dirty, and also غَطَّ رَأْسَهُ, so to out of shyness, out of more covering. This is a shy. This is it's not necessary to cover one's head, right? When going to the bathroom, it was out of shyness. He did it. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وروى الإمام الترمذي في الشمائل عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أنها قالت ما نظرت إلى فرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أو قالت ما رأيت فرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وذلك لشدة حيائه وكمال وقاره وتستره كل التستر. وفي شرح الشمائل للشيخ القاري والشيخ محمد بن قاسم جسوس روى ابن أبو صلاح عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها ما أتى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحدا من نسائه إلا مقنعا يرخي الثوب على رأسه وما رأيت من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولا رأى مني. أورده ابن الجوزي في كتابه الوفاء نقلا عن الخطيب انتهى. Imam Tirmidhi narrated in the Shema'il that Aisha radiallahu anha said, I never looked at or never saw the private parts of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this was due to his shyness and his perfect dignity and his desire to cover himself. Abu Salah narrated on the authority of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu that Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu anha said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never approached any of his wives except that he was covered with a cloth wrapped over his head. And I never saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's private parts, nor he mine. Bazar narrated that Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, the Messenger of Allah would bathe behind. I don't think I read that. So this is just, this is from the decorum of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His even approaching his, the intimacy with his wives, it was in a very, very shy manner, very shy manner, and it was you know, in a way to, you know, fulfill that which he needed to fulfill, but also it wasn't like indulgent, it wasn't indulgent, and that's what you can sense from these, you know, ahadith. Allahu a'lam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. It was mutual that the wives looked at him, his private parts, were, and he did not do the same for to them. So, and remember, this is the adab of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That doesn't mean it is something that must be done, or, you know, that you require your spouses to do the same. No, everybody is, you know, the sunnah for the spouses is that they, you know, take care of their spouse. So what their spouse needs is different. You know, they to, you know, fulfill the needs of their spouse. وأخرج البزار عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما قال رضي الله عنهما قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يغتسل من وراء الحجرات وما رأى أحد عورته فقط وإسناده حسن. Bazar narrated that Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would bathe behind the chambers, behind the hujurat, behind the rooms of his wives, and no one ever saw him, his awrah, his nakedness. In the court, وبهذا الذي ذكرناه فيما تقدم يعلم العاقل يقينا أن سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم قد نال أكمل مراتب الحياء وأعلاها. And from this, what we have narrated, it becomes clear to the person of intellect that our master Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam attained the highest ranks of shyness and modesty. ومهابته العظيمة صلى الله عليه وسلم وفخامته الكريمة. His great dignity and stateliness. So is how he was very dignified and great stature. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عظيم المهابة وقد توجه الله تعالى تاج العزة والكرامة قد توجه الله تعالى تاج العزة والكرامة تاج العزة والكرامة وكساوي حلة الفخامة. روى الترمذي وغيره من حديث هند بن أبي هالة يصف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فخما مفخما يتلألأ وجهه صلى الله عليه وسلم تلألؤ القمر ليلة البدر. وقال سيدنا علي رضي الله عنه في وصفه للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من رآه بديهة هابة ومن خالطه معرفة أحبه. وقد كان صحابة رضي الله عنهم لا يستطيعون إمعان النظر فيه لقوة مهابته ومزيد وقاره، ومن ثم لم يصفه إلا صغارهم أو من كان في تربيته قبل النبوة كهند بن أبي هالة وسيدنا علي رضي الله عنه. ويدل على ذلك ما رواه مسلم عن عبد الله بن عمرو رضي الله عنه قال صحبت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صحبة طويلة، سمعت منه أحاديث كثيرة وحفظت منه ألف مثل، ومع ذلك ما ملأت عيني منه قط حياء منه وتعظيما له، ولو قيل لي صفه لما قدرت صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam possessed great dignity, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala endowed him with honor and nobility and clothed him with the mantle of eminence. Tirmidhi and others narrated that Hind ibn Abi Hada said, describing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had great and stately attributes and was honored by su as such by others. His face shined like the light of the full moon. Our master Ali radiallahu anhu said, describing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whoever saw him unexpectedly would be awe-stricken, and whoever came to know him would love him. The companions, and this is something that I always mention about, you know, about loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first part, the first step to loving the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is having a very deep sense of waqar. You know, you come, you teach your kids, you teach your kids love, right? But you teach her, the first thing is have a waqar, to have this kind of it's in a sense of fear. It's a reverence, deep reverence. Like there's a big a sheikh, a grand mufti who comes, you don't go to him, you don't go and hug him and start laughing with him and joking around with him. You go, you kiss your hand, you're very careful about the way that you interact with them. You're very careful the way that you touch them, or make sure you don't want them to get disturbed in any way, right? So this is a very, so it starts how the Sina Ali said, when whoever saw him for the first time, they were awestrucken. They were filled with awe and like this kind of fear. Ahaba means like a fear and awe of him. But whoever got to know him, ma'rifatan, whoever mixed with him, got to know him, loved him. Okay, so it's after you mix with him, and mix with his seerah and mix with his ahadith, then that is, there's true deep love. But the first thing is what is normal is one should be awe-stricken of him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says the companions were unable to bring themselves to look at him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam closely because of the power of his dignity and gravity. This is why our descriptions of him come from the youngest of them, or those of them who had a hand in raising him before his prophetic mission, such as Hind ibn Abi Hala or our master Ali, who he raised them. Hind ibn Abi Hala is who? The son of Sayyidina Khadija. So he was raised by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he wasn't the son of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was in his care because he was the son of Sayyidina Khadija, right? So that's why, you know, you see that the younger, what he's trying to say is the younger, the Sahaba that were younger, they were the ones who were described the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like in Hind ibn Abi Hada, he was a young child growing up with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also such as Hind ibn Abi Hada or our master Ali radiallahu anhu, again, he was like 10 years old. And even before that, described by Sayyidina Ali as he was in his tarbiyah, in his care, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had taken him in when Abu Talib was very, he had a lot of children and there was a lot of, you know, poverty. So Abbas and Sina Abbas and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said they would take one of Abu Talib's sons to make it easier for Abu Talib. So he says, this is attested by Muslim's narration on the authority of Abdullah ibn Amr radiallahu anhu, who said, I kept the company of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for a long time and heard many of his sayings and memorized thousands of his parables, method. Despite all of that, out of shyness from him and reverence from him, I never once looked directly at him. And if I were asked to describe him, I would not be able to do so. SubhanAllah. This is just amazing, like just adab from the Sahaba, and also like just what just their experience with him, subhanAllah, how that was the case, subhanAllah. He said, if you were at, you would ask me to describe him, I couldn't. And I think it's not just not because he didn't look at him, but it was it's too it's it was it would be too overwhelming to him, or he couldn't describe it perfectly. He wouldn't be, he couldn't describe how that perfection, and it, the words, words are so imperfect to describe that perfection. ومن عظيم مهابته وكماله وقاره صلى الله عليه وسلم كان من جلس إليه صلى الله عليه وسلم أهابه وربما أخذته رعدة شديدة من قوة الهيبة المحمدية ولذلك كان صلى الله عليه وسلم يباسطهم ويلاطفهم ليسكن روعهم روى ابن ماجه والحاكم عن أبي مسعود البدري رضي الله عنه أنه قال جاء رجل فقام بين يدي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأخذته رعدة شديدة ومهابة فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هون عليك فأنا لست بملك ولا جبار وإنما أنا ابن امرأة من قريش كانت تأكل القديد بمكة فنطق الرجل بحاجته فقام النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا أيها الناس إني أوحي لي أن تواضعوا ألا تواضعوا حتى لا يبغي أحد على أحد ولا يفجر أحد وكونوا عباد الله يا إخوانا. So Ibn Majah, because of this, his great dignity and gravity, those who sat with him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would be awestricken by him and might even tremble, shake before him, tremble violently, shake before him. Upon this, he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would calm them down by being kind and gentle with them. If imagine, Hakim narrated that Abu Musa al-Badri, radiallahu anhu, said, a man came and stood before the Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and was overcome with trembling, shaking, and dread, like mahaba, being awed, stricken by awe. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, calm down, for I am no king or tyrant, but I Malik, as Malik, I'm but the son of a woman of the Quraysh who would eat dried meat in Mecca. You know, qadid is dried meat, is not of the finest meat, it's of the what the poorer would eat, jerky, meat jerky, right? So meaning he's mentioning this to show he, out of humility, otherwise he is Sayyidu Waladi Adam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the master of all of the children of Adam and master of all the creation, right? Master of all the creation on the day of Adam, even Adam and Ibrahim alayhi salam, they're under him on the day of judgment. But he didn't mention that because this man is already overwhelmed. What is he going to mention? He's mentioned something to calm him, something he's showing him his humility. Well, I'm from the daughter, I'm the son of a woman who used to eat meat chicken, meaning, you know, don't, you know, be calmed, you know, calm down. That's subhanAllah. This is from his mercy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So then the man spoke of his need. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood and said, O people, it has been revealed to me that you should humble yourselves. So humble yourselves so that no one will oppress another and no one will be proud. Servants of Allah, be brothers. وعن قيل بنت مخرمة أنها قالت لما رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم متخشعا في الجسة وهو قاعد في القرفصاء ورعدت في الفرق من الفرق أي الخوف فقال رجل يا رسول الله عرئدة مسكينة قالت قيل فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولم ينظر إلي وأنا عند ظهري يا مسكينة عليك السكينة. So Qayla bint Makhrama said, when I saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sitting humbly on his heels, I began to shiver in fear. And a man said, O Messenger of Allah, the poor thing is trembling. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, without looking round to see me, she was behind him. She said, O poor girl, miskina is, O poor, like a poor girl, miskin, poor thing. Poor girl, be at peace. Ya miskina, aleiki عليك السكينة. Upon you السكينة, سكينة is peace and calmness. And so he actually put that like upon her. But here it's interesting, subhanAllah, how she is shaking when she sees him in a very humble position. She sees him in a sitting in a very humble position, and she's, it's not, you know, this is very interesting to point out. Because it's not like he's wearing his armor and he has a sword, which that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us to see that. And that there's not going to be any jihad and stuff like that, right? In the akhirah. Still, I subhanAllah, I want to see that jalad, to see that that look, how he looked, and subhanAllah, and Hunayn, and how he wore his armor, sometimes double armor in his helmet. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is, you know, going out to fight for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How he looked, amazing. But he's not wearing his helmet and his armor, and he doesn't have his sword. He's sitting in a very humble position. And there's other narrations where he's, the way he sits, he sits and eats like a somebody who's very in need of food, like a poor person in need of food, very humble sitting. But it was this humble sitting that she said, when I saw him in this, what the khashi'an fi jasati is, متخشعاً is not just let's see, how did he translate it? Sitting humbly on his, he was sitting قرفصاء. قرفصاء, actually, I think this is the how do you say, the way you sit, like pretzel, I forgot. Either the pretzel way or cross-legged. I think kurfusa is cross-legged. I don't know how he translated here. He doesn't translate it. He's cross-legged, and here he says sitting on his heels. I don't think so. It's kurfusa is cross-legged, and it's, so it's a very simple way. It's not like he's sitting on a chair or a throne, right? Nothing of that sort. But she said, when I saw him, متخشعاً is somebody who is has khushu'. Has khushu' is like God consciousness. So here she, it's not about the way he's sitting, it's about seeing him this humbled state, but with khushu'. And that is what made her tremble. What is it? What is it? It's because when she looked at him, she saw the jalad of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's like looking at his humility and knowing that his humility is, it's only connected, is he has this humility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, he's Sayyidu Walidi Adam. To know that he is the greatest and he is the master of all creation, and he's sitting that humble for the sake of the jalad of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? And that's what made her tremble. And that is, that is a believer, that when you look at that person, he reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so she saw so many meanings in that. So many meanings, subhanAllah. And so the other, you know, when the other sahabi says, oh, this poor thing is trembling. And he says, oh, poor thing, be at peace. But there's levels, there's different sahabi, had different of the sahaba saw different things. Right, this woman, when she saw him, she saw this, saw so many meanings in that look, and that spirit. There's almost, it's almost like some spiritual, you know, there's spiritual veils. So as though a spiritual veil was lifted for her, specifically because the other companions, perhaps they didn't have that same feeling at that time, right? So there was like a spiritual veil that she saw. Something very deep and connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that it wasn't just haba for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but that jalal that she felt connected to the greatness, the azamatullah, the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so she, that happened. And then he says, these stories of the Kapanis clearly show the power of his dignified composure. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I forgot to read this last part. فَلَمَا قَالَهَا أَذْهَبُ اللَّهُ مَا كَانَ دَخَلَ قَلْبِي مِنَ الرُّعْبِ. وفي هذه الوقائع مع بعض الصحابة دليل ظاهر على قوة مهابته صلى الله عليه وسلم. And she says that when he said it, Allah removed the fear that had entered my heart. Why? Because the way he said it, he said, Ya maskina alayki sakina. He didn't say that. That's what's really interesting, okay? When you say, be at peace, like command, alayki bis sakina. What's the difference? This is somebody, if you know Arabic well, you're going to be able to catch this. Alayki bis sakina mean be at peace, meaning you try to calm yourself down, be peaceful. But he didn't say that. He said alayki sakina. He put the sakina on her. So that's the difference. He alayki sakina, upon you is peace. That means he, like we say alayki assalamu alaykum, alaykum assalam, wa alaykum assalam. We're not asking them to be peaceful. We're it's a dua. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the peace of Allah, the peace, the assalam be upon you, right? So like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what is his dua or what is his command here? His command be putting the sakina on her. And so she says, when he said that, the fear came out of my heart. Or she doesn't say fear. She says, أذهب الله ما كان دخل قلبي من الرعب. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took out whatever was in my heart of fear. Yes, of and he says, and so I will, we're going to stop there. So it keeps going a little bit. And we say, جزالله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأهله. جزالله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأهله. جزالله عنا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وأهله. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون. سلام على المرسلين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. واغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافينا واعف عنا. يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم فرج عن أهل غزة، اللهم فرج عن أهل فلسطين، اللهم فرج عن المسلمين في كل مكان. يا رب العالمين يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين يا أرحم الراحمين. Oh Allah, we ask you, يا رب, you are our Lord. We have no one else to ask you, but we turn to you and ask you. You are our Lord. Who can we go to beside you? There is no one we go to beside you. There are no one we stretch our hands out, our bare empty hands out, except to you, Ya Rabbi Al-Alamin. Ya Rabbi, we ask you on this blessed day, in this blessed month of that is your month, Shahrullah Muharram, Ya Allah, we ask you, please give relief to our brothers and sisters in Palestine and Gaza. Please give them relief. Please give them safety. Ya Salam, Ya Salam. Give them salam. Give them peace in their homes, in their hearts, in their lives, Ya Rabbi Al-Alamin. If they don't have peace outside in their, we ask you to give them peace in their ultan, in their communities, in their towns, in their villages, in their cities. Ya Rabbi Al-Alamin, the cities of the Muslims. Ya Allah, Ya Rahman Rahimin. And if they don't have peace outside, Ya Rabb, give them peace in their heart. Give them yaqeen, give them nur in their heart. Ya Allah, be with them. Anas whom, Ya Rabbi Al-Alamin, Ya Rahman Rahimin. Anas whom, be with them. And cover them with your lutf, Ya Latif, Ya Latif, Ya Rahim, Ya Khabir. You are the most knowledgeable. You know them. You know what they are going through better than us. You know every intricate detail of what they are going through. Everyone they lost, everything they lost, every house they lost, every disease they lost, every loved one they lost, the food that they lost, the water, their jobs, their lives, what they have gone through. Ya Rabbi Al-Alamin, you know everything. Have mercy on them. But bijahi Sayyidil Mursaleen, faraj anhum, Ya Rabbi, Ya Rabbi, Ya Rabbi. And make us of those who give nusra to your deen. Make us those who give victory to your deen. Give victory in our families, in ourselves, in our households, to our children, with our spouses, with ourselves, with our lower selves. Make us those who have victory. And so that we may give your people, let me give this ummah victory. Allahumma ansur ummat sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma ighfir ummat sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allahumma a'izz ummat sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Arham ummat sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh Allah, have mercy on the ummah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah have mercy, and Allah forgive the messenger of ummah of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh Allah, give victory to the ummah of the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh Allah, give opening and relief to the ummah of your messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah, oh Allah, forgive and give a lutf to the ummah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Assalamu ala mursalin. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Allahumma taqabbal min ma jaa sayyidi al-mursalin. Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Barakallahu fiikum. Assalamu alaykum.